every city's music scene deserves a book like this.
I suppose when you're writing a book about something, you want the title to give you a bit of a hint what it's about. So I called mine When Rock Got Rolling. And it's kind of a fond look back to the heyday of the pop music scene in Wellington, 1960 to 1970. But what I found was that Wellington really rocked back then. In the late 50s and early 60s, most public dances happened in the town hall. There were huge jamborees with thousands of kids jiving away to several bands. Maybe the Supersonics, or the Tornadoes from Titai Bay, or the hottest band in town, the Premiers.
Yeah, we used to play at all sorts of venues. We'd play at dances and the town hall here. And we used to do quite a lot of the hi-fi club dances with Des Britain. They were fun. It was a different thing those days, of course. There were thousands of kids in here, up to 2,000 kids in here, 2.5, I think, was the biggest crowd we had. And they'd be standing, moving around, dancing. It was a very occasional fist fight, but there was never any problem with alcohol or drugs or things those days. It was a simpler time. We were playing a lot of music that was Shadows music. We didn't play very often. There were very few professional bands around then. And we didn't get paid very much either. You could never make a living at it.
The other major early 60s venue was the St. Francis Hall up in Hill Street. That became known as Tinarama later on, and then the Monaco, and battles of the bands were still being held there in the late 60s. But back in 62 and 63, it was a regular gig for the Premier's closest rivals, the Librettos.
It was basically where it all began, I think, around Wellington. Rocky used to sing there. And
right, your band had to back me.
Well, sure, but what a pleasure.
I think most of our audience would be the same age as I was. It's going to be my age away, isn't it? No, about 16, 17.
Yeah.
And it was, you know, it was a big thing, Tinarama.
The sound equipment we had in those days was really quite primitive. There were no mixing systems. We used to actually, to mix the sound, we used to have leads on our guitars, and they were 200 feet long. We used to go down to the end of the hall in the afternoon and try and sort of get the sound quality right.
Yeah. I can remember you singing away there and all the girls screaming and oohing and aahing.
No, I don't think so.
Yes, and then Rod would do his solo.
And across town, a real British guitar band were resident at the Carousel Cabaret up in Tory Street. Tony and the Initials.
It was sort of a rock entertainment sort of a band, you know, and this was just a lovely place. They shouldn't have pulled it down. I mean, the band wasn't really that bad. It was before 10 o'clock closing, and there was no skullduggery, except we had a few smugglers in. I think the drinks those days were Horse's Neck and Pim's Number One, I think. But nobody could see it, just sort of blended in with the Coke. You know what sort of happens. We needed an expert to draw up agreements and all that sort of stuff for this wonderful place, so that we all became shareholders. So that we needed an expert to do that. So we found who worked cheap, this whiz kid. I think it was his first job. And he drew up all these agreements for us. Tony and the Initials, the Carousel, big stamps all over it. Never forget his name. It was Ron Brierley. Wonderful.
So these bands were basically guitar bands. They were doing stuff by the Shadows and the Ventures. Then when the Beatles hit, promoters got into the act with a vengeance. Bands were popping up all over the place, and clubs opened in town and out in the suburbs. Of course, then the guitar bands were swamped by the beat groups, and the live scene got even bigger. The most popular clubs in town? Well, there were plenty to choose from. Clubs like The Place and the Montmartre in Chew's Lane.
We're what's left of the Avengers in New Zealand. Our drummer Hank Davis is still in Sydney. He's been there for a long time, 20 years, which is when the band broke up. And this is where we used to play. This is the entrance of The Place, where everybody, one of Wellington's busiest night spots, I suppose. A lot of action here. And we'd come along here and in our bell bottoms and our horse riding boots and big heels and chisel toes and do our thing, really.
Well, we played cover versions of the popular overseas songs at the time. Mainly English material and lots of vocal harmony.
We didn't make a fortune out of it. I think we tended to do it for love.
Fame?
Well, hopefully that would happen, but whether that happened or not, that is...
$30 a week.
Yeah.
Or the Mexicali, later called the Hideaway, just down the lane and across Victoria Street.
Towards the late 60s, I worked here with the Bitter End, and it was bands like ourselves and Barry and the Breakaways. We used to play R&B, and it eventually turned out to be the R&B centre of Wellington. There was no alcohol, nothing was licensed, but they used to sneak their own flask in and just sit in the dark and get drunker and drunker, but it was really, really good. The people that used to come, we used to get a really an amazing audience. We used to get the mods, the hippies, the hard cases, a few head cases, the transvestites, a few pros, but they all made it a good night, and you know, it used to be amazing.
And the Downtown Club, around the corner in Jervois Quay. The most amazing thing was the fact that there were over 160 bands working Wellington and the Hut back then, and the clubs kept them pretty busy. Places like the Platter Rack in Willis Street, where you could have seen Max Merritt and the Meteors, maybe the Avengers, or Sounds Unlimited.
It was a seedy little rat hole, actually. It didn't really have much going for it, except that the people who came here were musically inclined, and Sounds Unlimited always thought of themselves as being a sort of more musical band than the typical genre of pop bands, I guess. We would do probably, in those days, that was 5-6 nights a week regular playing. Fridays and Saturdays, we'd do probably 2 gigs Friday, 2 on a Saturday. Sunday afternoons was out to a youth club. Sunday nights was always back here at the Platter Rack, and I figured it was our best crowd. Certainly our initiation to the wide world of chemicals happened right here in the Platter Rack, as did our initiation to the world of what was known then as groupies.
Around the Herbert Street, Manor Street area were the Sheridan and Lucifers. In Guzney Street, there was the Empress and the Sorrento. And up in Cuba Street, Ali Barber's opened in the late 60s and featured bands like Tom Thumb.
We used to start at a place called The Place, which is about a mile down the road, and we had to finish there at 12, and we had to start here at 12:30 or we'd get fined. So there's the little pop stars in their leather jackets and their bell bottoms and their Cuban heel boots, and we're running out the road carrying our gear, and we get here and it's full of drunks, of course, at the time of night, isn't it? And up there there's a dog leg stairway, and it's the whole thing's done out like a cave. So we're trying to struggle upstairs with our gear, and down the stairs are coming drunks and bottles, and we get up there and it's like arriving at a party that's halfway through. And there's pimps and there's prostitutes and there's teeny boppers, and it's all go.
Of course, this is just scratching the surface, but it's pretty obvious that we produced some great bands through that decade. Bands like The Dedication, The Simple Image, The Roadrunners, The Calculated Risk, and of course, The Fourmyula.
It was a very volatile scene in Wellington, and I'm talking about sort of 68, 69. The Fourmyula were a fairly popular band. They had lots of successful chart records, so the gigs were big. We started out from school in Heritonga College, moved on to doing Bible class dances. You'd pray maybe once a week, twice a week. Girls would bring a plate. Boys would wear a tie, and that solved all the problems. And then Ellie and me, he was a bass player, Ellie Richardson, we discovered this book, Teach Yourself Songwriting, which is a series of books like Teach Yourself Spanish, Teach Yourself Russian. And we had a little read of it, and we thought, gosh, this makes so much sense. All we have to do is rhyme these words and make up these tunes. And we read it, and we gave it to each other, and we went into his place with a piano, rumor has it. And we sat down and wrote the first song, Come With Me, which actually is... It's not exactly right, but it was a very helpful little book, and we lost a copy and our careers faded immediately.
Back in 1966, Wellington was said to be the most happening scene in the country. There were 10 weekly dances, 20 night spots, 7 youth clubs and over 80 coffee bars, many of them featuring live music of some kind. So what happened? Some say TV ruined the live entertainment scene. Some say 10 o'clock closing killed it off. There's truth in both of those reasons, but everyone who remembers the 60s in Wellington says the same thing. It was a great time. I wanted to find out about it, and this book is the result of my curiosity. It's a flick through scrapbooks, photos, records, and memories back to the days when rock
got rolling.